Tropical depression Heneras left the Philippine area of responsibility Wednesday morning as tropical storm Helen enters PAR. Let's get more details now from Pag-asa weather forecaster Chanel Dominguez. Chanel, good afternoon. What's the weather like?
Good afternoon, Stanley, and good afternoon to everyone. So we are currently monitoring two tropical cyclones. However, only one is inside our Philippine area of responsibility, which is Helen. It was last estimated at 1,060 kilometers east-northeast of extreme northern Luzon. It is moving northwestward at a speed of 25 kilometers per hour with sustained winds of 85 kilometers per hour and gustiness up to 105 kilometers per hour. Tropical storm Helen is in the northeastern boundary of our Philippine area of responsibility, so landfall and any tropical cyclone wind signal is unlikely to be raised. Due to this, expect also the effect of southwest monsoon, which is affecting southern Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Expect heavy to intense rains over Palawan, Occidental Mindoro, and Antique. That's the latest here, Pag-asa Weather Forecasting Center. Chanel Dominguez, and good afternoon.
And Chanel, is this the kind of weather pattern that we can expect for the rest of the week, given that you mentioned it will enhance the southwest monsoon?
We can expect an improving weather starting tomorrow as the southwest monsoon continues to weaken the effect here in our country.
All right. Thank you so much, Chanel Dominguez. Vice President Sara Duterte appeared this morning before a House inquiry into her office's fund use. But after branding the hearing a well-funded and coordinated political attack, Duterte left the hearing. Vivian Gulia is on the line with an update. Viv, go ahead.
Hi, Stanley. The House Committee on Good Government and Public Accountability begins deliberations on the privileged speech of Manila's 2nd District Representative Rolando Valeriano, questioning Vice President Sara Duterte's utilization of public funds, including the 125 million pesos in confidential funds in 2022. Duterte appeared before the panel earlier today, denying there was misuse of public funds in the OVP. She said that if there are audit findings or legitimate cases, she will gladly respond to them before the commission and audit or the court. The vice president said she is not seeking any treatment or special treatment or invoking any tradition, reiterating that her office leaves it 2025 budget to Congress. She said that if Congress is unsatisfied by her office's documentary submissions, it can choose to slash the OVP's budget. For Duterte, the House panel hearing is no ordinary legislative inquiry, but a, quote, well-funded and coordinated political attack. He accused it of aiming to discredit her to prevent future political contests. The VP alleged that the panel is trying to make a case for impeachment against her. Here is a portion of her statement before the House panel.
I will not allow myself to be subjected to an inquiry based on an empty privilege speech just so you can attack me and do indirectly what you failed to do directly during the budget hearings. If you feel that all the documentary submissions are not enough, then by all means, huwag kayo magbigay ng budget. Sa totoo lang, hindi naman ang budget ang puntirya ninyo dahil napakadali naman magtanggal ng budget. What you are trying to do is make a case for impeachment.
The House Committee on Appropriations previously recommended slashing more than half of the proposed 2.037 billion peso budget of the OVP for next year, and that is a unanimous decision, according to Committee Senior Vice Chairperson and Marikina 2nd District Representative Stella Kimbo, because according to her findings from the commission, there were findings from the commission on audit on issues regarding surrounding the OVP budget. And there are also redundant programs with those programs implemented by other government agencies. And Duterte then requested the committee to terminate the inquiry for its alleged lack of any proposed legislation or substantive matter for discussion. But panel chairperson, Representative Joe Otula, said that the committee has already taken cognizance of the privileged speech and will proceed. Duterte refused to be placed under oath, saying she is not a witness but a mere resource person based on the invitation sent by the committee to her office. Chua allowed her to not take her oath. Minutes later, the vice president requested to leave the hearing even before it was terminated. Chua agreed to excuse Duterte. Lawmakers now continue to propound questions to representatives of the Commission on Audit and the Department of Budget and Management. Stanley, back to you.
All right. So just to make that clear, she walked out of that hearing. And is it really official that the deliberations are terminated, or is there any timeline for that? What have you heard, Viv?
Stanley, there was a request from the vice president to leave or be excused from the hearing even before it was terminated, and it was granted. That request was granted by the committee chairperson, Representative Chua. But at this point, the committee hearing continues, and lawmakers are asking questions to representatives of the Commission on Audit and the Department of Budget and Management. So the hearing continues at this time.
And as you've said, they are hearing comments from Commission on Audit and other officials. How much more would that achieve or accomplish in terms of, you know, pushing that budget for the vice president's office, or slashing it even?
Well, Stanley, the lawmakers so far are asking questions about the 125 million pesos or the utilization of 125 million pesos confidential funds of the Office of the Vice President in 2022. If you can recall, the Commission on Audit previously issued a notice of disallowance regarding the 73 million of that pesos, of that total 125 million pesos in confidential funds. But according to Duterte, her office has submitted its response, and she assured that she will fully cooperate with the ongoing and unfinished audit of COA. Stanley?
All right, on that note, thank you so much for those updates, Vivian Gulia. Thanks again. Disgraced former Bamban Mayor Alice Guo now facing a qualified human trafficking case. The Justice Department filed the case before the Pasig City Regional Trial Court. This after the Supreme Court ordered the transfer of ghost cases in connection with illegal POGOs to Pasig City and Valenzuela City. Now, aside from Guo, also named as respondents were Huang Jihyang, Zhang Ruijin, and three others.